Hey folks, it's Zach from Epic Games. If you didn't already know, Unreal Engine 4.7 is out, and if you don't have it, you should get it, because there's a ton of new features. And one of those features is the ability to create blueprintable components. So what we wanted to do in this video is give you a really quick idea of what that means, an overview of how they work, or at least some of the ways you can use them. And it's just really cool, so let me show you this. So here is a project that we put together. It's a little spaceship shooter, and it's pretty simple. Like, this is all done in paper 2D. We have a ship that flies around, you shoot lasers. There's little power-ups that make his lasers more powerful. But you'll notice it's missing bad guys. So what we'll do is we'll make a bad guy for the game using our in-editor asset creation workflow, along with some blueprintable custom components that I put together. And then, if there's time, I'll make one from scratch to kind of show you how that workflow goes. So let's start off by adding in a new empty pawn, which is, it's a pawn that does nothing, really. Let's go ahead and make sure that that is at 0 in Y, because that's where the game plane exists. Again, this is a 2D game, so 0 in Y is where the game is actually going. Let's add a new component. We're going to add a sphere component. So here in the details panel, let's just type sphere. And what we want is sphere collision. We'll leave the name as sphere. This can be really informal, super simple. Now, under my sprites that I've created here, I've got a bunch of random sprites. There's one called Magnetic Mine. I'm just going to drag and drop on top of this. This is just to give us something to render here in our view. So now you can see our little sprite. He's got a little bit of depth. He responds to lighting, but he is 2D. It's just a clever use of a normal map. Nothing super fancy. So that's what we have. Now, every other piece of functionality we have broken up into a series of components. So we have a 2D shooter movement component. We have explode on death, hurts to touch, and so forth. All of these were written entirely within Blueprint, and we can now just drag and drop these onto this object to define behavior. So let's start with the 2D shooter movement component. This component was designed in such a way that it defines how this object can move through space. If I open it up really quick, we won't get too tied up in this, but we'll go ahead and crack this open. You can see that what we're doing is on initialize, which is kind of like the quote-unquote begin play for a component. Basically, the moment this component springs to life, we are getting a reference to its owner, we're casting that out to a pawn, and then I'm just storing that so I don't have to go through all this rigmarole later. And then on every tick, we're making sure that the pawn is still valid. We're grabbing the movement input component, movement input vector. Let me say that the right way. And really all we're doing is using that to add a local offset to the object. Now, the only part of this you may not already know is that the movement input component is what would come in from any source of input, like a gamepad or whatever, but it can also come in from an AI controller. So we're doing a quick check here and seeing, is there an AI controller on this object? And if there is, then just go ahead and move the object around. If there's not, then that means this is being driven probably by a player, and we've got some screen limiting math, which I'll open it, and it looks really scary, but it's just a bunch of Boolean operations to see what side of the screen we're on, and then that just multiplies the input vector by zero. Basically, the easy way to look at this is it just locks us so that we can't move outside a certain range on the screen. That's really the only thing that would be important to us in this example. But that's our movement component, right? And the cool thing is that this is the exact same movement component that is used to move our little hero spaceship that you saw me flying around or shooting lasers. So now, this object we've created has the ability to move around, but having the ability is not the same as having the will or the drive. And for that, we need an AI component. So here I have a custom blueprint component called AI Selector, which I can drag and drop on. And this just provides the user with a drop down for the different types of AI controller that we've created in this project. So we can tell that this object could just move down the screen or all kinds of different behaviors. Let's choose chase the player. So now I've only added two components. We've got 2D shooter and AI selector set to chase the player. So with just that, let's hit play. And it's not going to do anything while we're invincible, because you're invincible for like the first 4 seconds of the game. And then all of a sudden, he starts chasing us around the screen, which is pretty special. But nothing else happens, right? I can't shoot it. I can't really interact with it. So let's fix those. Let's say we want to be able to shoot this and have it blow up. So we have a takes damage component, which I'll open up again really, really quickly. So you can see just kind of on initialize, we're getting the owner and we're binding a custom event to whenever the owner takes damage. We're simply saying whenever whoever owns this particular component, whenever that owner takes damage, we want to do some stuff, and here's what we want to do. We just want to take their existing health, subtract away however much damage just came in, and then reset that to the new health. And then we also have a check for death function, which is doing a really quick comparison. It's like, hey, is your health less than zero, buddy? Because if it is, you probably ought to be destroyed. And there is a special case here for the hero ship, because he actually has a death and respawn action. We're not going to get kind of swept up in that, though. So let's close a lot of these out. Let's jump back all the way to our level. So again, now we could just take the takes damage component, drag and drop that on, and set whatever our base health needs to be, and hit play. So now I can just shoot it and the thing goes away. But, and if that was like super fast, what just happened was I shot it and the thing ceased to exist, but that was kind of boring. So I'm gonna quit opening up the components. They are all really super simple, but we have an explode on death component. I can now drag and drop that on. So now let's hit play again. And we can shoot, and cool, now it explodes when we hit it. And again, it's just a really tiny little piece of scripted behavior that's completely enclosed inside of that component. Just by adding it, we start further defining what this pawn can do. Now, let's see, a couple of other things. Let's say we want this guy to hurt us if he touches us, because it is chasing us, right? So if it ever hits us, it'd be cool if it hurt us. So we'll drag on a hurts to touch component, and that has a collision damage, which is set to 500. We'll also make it damage itself. And okay, I said I wouldn't do this, but just kind of give you a little bit of insight. You can see each one of these components is just a tiny little snippet of Blueprint script. They're all very, very small. And in a lot of cases, all they're doing is just binding to some existing event that's already on the pawn. So now let's test that out. We'll hit play. And we have to not be invincible anymore for the behavior to become a thing. And he chases us, and as soon as he hits us, boom, we both explode, which is awesome. So now let's add on another one. We have a score component. And the score component gives us the ability to assign a score, which we'll do like, I don't know, 3,184. I don't know. That's just like random number. And now if I come over and I shoot, and I don't know how well you can see this, but in the upper left-hand corner of the screen, my score is now 3184. So that's now working. So you can see how this component-based workflow allows me to take all of the important parts of the behavior for my game, break them up into each of these components, and then I can just drag and drop on the ones that I need. But where do you go from here? So I've got this thing, it's defined, it's doing what I want it to do, but now I can take that and convert it over to a blueprint. So let's do that. Let's make a new folder, which I'll call My Special Enemies. And then inside this folder, we'll just give this blueprint a name. We'll call it My Special Enemy. That seems like the best possible case. And we'll create that. Awesome. So now this has been replaced with a blueprint. We could even open it up inside the blueprint editor. We could start adding further script to it. We could start giving it all kinds of brand new behavior if we wanted to. Like it doesn't stop here. Technically, it only starts here. Like we've only begun the process. But I mean, if we were happy, cool. We could grab something like our little spawn volume. And this is something that's in my level. It's a custom blueprint object. At a glance, if I was to open it up so you could see it, really all it's doing is just spawning enemies from somewhere within its volume. That's really the basis of it all. But it has a property for what type of enemy class it's spawning. So I could set this to the brand new My Special Enemy that we just created. And now when I play the game, as soon as we're not invulnerable, as soon as we can be killed, they're going to start spawning into the screen. And here they come. And they're all chasing me. And they're all very scary. And we can start blowing them up. Boom, 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 boom. Awesome. But what if, you know, we decide later we wanted more functionality? I mean, we've converted this to a blueprint. And it's real easy to fall into the trap of thinking that once you've done that, you know, you're done and you're really not. So let's create a brand new component of our own to add a new piece of behavior. I'm just going to right click and we'll create a new blueprint class. Now, here are your new features for this. You have actor component and you have scene component. An actor component let me go the other way with that. A scene component is a component that has its own relative location, meaning like a location relative to where the actor is. You could move it around. Think kind of like the way an arrow component already works inside of Blueprint. You can kind of position that anywhere relative within the Blueprint, and same with a scene component. An actor component doesn't really care. It could be placed, it really has no key location in and of itself, so that's what we're going to use. So we'll create a new actor component, and let's call this Fire at Player. And that's what this is going to do. This is going to be behavior designed to allow our bad guy to start shooting at the player. We'll open this up. And we have two events here that are super important. We have initialize and we have tick. So initialize is what happens basically when this component is added to an actor. The moment this component is born, everything attached to this is going to happen. Tick is exactly what it sounds like. It's something that will happen on every tick of the game. Of course, be very careful with this because heavy tick operations tend to add up and lead to performance problems. It doesn't mean you should avoid them. It means you should be very careful with how you use them. So what I'm going to do is create a custom event. And let's give this a name. Let's call this fire. That's easy enough to remember. Now what we're going to do when we fire is we're going to get the player pawn. And from that, we are going to make sure that that's actually the hero ship. So we'll drag a wire off and we'll cast to the hero ship. And we'll connect that up like so. Now, we need to, here's kind of a fun thing. That damage component that we applied to our enemy ship that we built, that exact same damage component exists on our hero. So we will get that. Again, we're just reusing the same components over and over again. So get the damage component. And then that has its own custom property for invulnerability. So we'll get whether or not the player is invulnerable. That's because during the first 3 to 4 seconds of gameplay, you can't kill the player. If you don't have that in place, the game is actually really hard to play. So let's drag a wire off this and we'll do a branch. Now the reason we're doing this branch is just so that if the player is invulnerable, we're technically not going to do anything. As soon as they are not invulnerable, so as soon as this tests out to false, we want to spawn an actor from class. And what we want to spawn is a class that we've created called Enemy Shot. So this is just a basic projectile class. All it does is it fires forward. When it hits something, it applies damage to it. It's pretty basic. So now that we've got that, though, we need to know the direction that we're going to be shooting in. So let's do a little bit of super basic vector math. Let's get the player pawn once again. And we will also get our owner's location. So get owner once again. And both of these, we need to get their location in space. So let's drag a wire out. We'll say get actor location. And I'll copy paste so that we're doing that for both of them. So now we know where both of these objects live in the world at this particular moment. We're going to subtract the location of the pawn from the location. Actually, other way around, right? We're going to subtract the location of the owner away from the location of the player pawn. And we're going to get the X vector rotation. So just type in X vector. And this makes a rotator starting from the X axis of the vector. So now let's take our spawn transform. I'm going to right click on this. This is awesome if you didn't know you could do this. And we'll split the struct pin. And we'll drive rotation with our new calculation. And where are we going to shoot from? Well, that'll be the owner's location. So we'll just drag a wire straight up to that. And with that, we should be ready to shoot. We just have a little bit more work to do because this is just a custom event. But right now, nothing is firing that custom event. So when we initialize the component, what we'll do is we will set a timer. And this timer is going to call the fire function. In fact, just because I'm a little OCD, we'll capitalize fire. All right, so now we need to set up the interval at which it's going to call this. Now, I'm going to do something a little bit fancy because I want this to be very easy for a user to be able to utilize. So let's create a new variable, and we will call this fire frequency range. And we're going to set its type to a vector, set this to a vector 2D. And we'll give this a range of 1 second to 3 seconds for its default value. Now, if I drag this into the scene, I can immediately right-click on its pin and split that struct pin. So now I have X and I have Y. Now check this out. We can grab the first one and do a random float in range, and then use those two numbers to drive max and min, and that becomes my time. Now, if I just take this new variable and make it editable, when I compile, what this means is if I drop this component onto any given object in my scene or anything, I will be able to see a max and min time where it should be shooting. So let's test this out. Now, I have already converted my enemy. If I go under my special enemies, it is now a blueprint. So if I want to add further components, I need to do that within the blueprint editor. So let's double click this guy. And then here's his component list. There's all those components that I added. Let's add one more. We'll add the new fire at player component. When we select it, you'll see that it's got fire frequency range. The 1 to 3 second default is going to be fine, but we could totally change that if we wanted to. So now let's play the game. And again, nothing happens while we're invulnerable, which is all well and good. And then as soon as we're not invulnerable, oh, the guys are actually blowing themselves up when they get shot, which is not super useful. So there is actually a fix to that. We'll just kind of laugh at that one. The enemy shot is a special custom class that needs to know if it's being fired from an enemy. And because I didn't check that, basically what's happening is all of these shots are colliding with the enemies right as they shoot them, so they're blowing themselves up, which makes the game a little too easy. So we'll check fired from enemy, and we'll hit play one more time. And we need fanfare. I need music for this game, I really do. Oh, now they're all shooting at me, and they're chasing me, and they'll explode if they touch me. And you see that, like, how easy that was for me to create this entirely new bit of behavior. Now, of course, on the back end, there was some work to do, right? There were different scripts. I created different AI controllers that we could switch between. So there was, like, you know, the one that chases the enemy. There were a few others that I didn't show. Of course, there was the actual scripting of each one of these components, which didn't take place in this video. But the point is, with this new component-driven workflow, you don't have to just make a game. You can make a framework that makes building your games easier as you move forward. So now I could have people on my team whose job it was to come up with new things to live in my world, like asteroids and space debris and boss characters and all kinds of things like that. And they could just simply drag and drop on the components that they need, or we could write new ones as we decide we need more behavior. So that wraps it up for this video. I just wanted to show you guys this new workflow in Unreal Engine 4.7. Please go get the engine. If you're interested in what you've seen, you want to try it out, go get 4.7 right now. I can't wait to see what you've made, and I'll talk to you later.